we'll try it. Here we are. 444. Ready?
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. He's on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies.
Oh.
Well, you folks ready for a long ride tonight? I hope you are. We're going on a long ride tonight. If I keep my comments short, maybe we'll do all right. But I'm going to start with the text in Zechariah chapter 2, verse 1 through 9. Sorry, Tony. Zechariah chapter 2, verse 1 through 9. Remember Zechariah, Malachi, Matthew, so it's easy enough to find. Zechariah chapter 2, verse 1 through 9. When you find your place, stand with me if you would. God's word says this. In Zechariah 2, start at verse 1 down through verse 9. I lifted up mine eyes again and looked, and behold, a man with a measuring line in his hand. Then said I, whither goest thou? And he said unto me, to measure Jerusalem, to see what is the breadth thereof and what is the length thereof. And behold, the angel that talked with me went forth, and another angel went out to meet him. And he said unto him, run, speak to this young man, saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls, for the multitude of men and cattle therein. Excuse me. For I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire round about, and will be the glory in the midst of her. Ho, ho, come forth, and flee from the land of the north, saith the Lord. For I have spread you abroad as the four winds of the heavens, saith the Lord. Deliver thyself, O Zion, that dwellest with the daughter of Babylon. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, after the glory hath he sent me unto the nations which spoiled you. For he that toucheth you toucheth the apple of his eye. For behold, I will shake mine hand upon them, and they shall be a spoil to their servants, and ye shall know that the Lord of hosts hath sent me. Father, I come to you, and I thank you again for meeting with us. And thank you for the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ and how important it is that we have a Savior that was God in the flesh. And we've learned a lot about our Savior that way, to see him as fully God and fully man. But Lord, tonight I want to look at some things and see some things here about you and about our Savior that are stolen. And so please just help. May I have power of thy Holy Spirit upon me, so that we'll go from this place rejoicing that we have the great Savior that we do. Lord, just help each one that's here, even help Blaine's hand stop bleeding and be all right there, and just other things that all of us need, and those by way of internet, that they might come to know Christ as Savior. So Lord, do some great things, and we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The passage that we have here, of course, is a prophecy about Israel and Jerusalem and coming up in the future, that when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back, he's going to set up his kingdom, and it's going to be incredible. And Jerusalem is going to be, as we read here in verse 4, is going to be inhabited as towns without walls for the multitude of men and cattle therein. For I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire round about. You know, it's going to be an incredible place. Not going to have to be fortified. That's the idea of the walls. The walls were for fortification. But what we see there at verse 6, ho, ho, come forth and flee from the land of the north. Who says ho, ho, but Santa Claus? And I hate to be the one to break it to you, but there is no Santa Claus. Sorry to tell you that, but there isn't. He's a lie. And he's a thief. Surely, Satan is his father. In fact, you only have to arrange the letters just a little bit. You go from Satan to Santa. That's a scary thing. Remember, Satan's the father of all lies. And Santa Claus is a lie. And he's a thief. He stole these verses of scripture about Israel right here. We're going to see some more. Now, a lot of times people won't preach against Santa Claus because if they do, half their congregation will leave. I mean, they all believe in him, take their kids to him, you know, have pictures of him, that kind of thing around. you know, they'll If they stay at all, they'll say to the pastor, you shouldn't preach that message. You're ruining Christmas for the kids. I don't know. I'd rather not. Some will say, well, you know, we just do it for fun. You know, fun? Really? You know, I don't think it's just for fun. You know, that the Lord Jesus Christ is not just for fun. You know, that's for sure. And to steal the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, not just for fun. And that's what Santa Claus does. He steals the glory. You know, this ho-ho and all this part that's here is about God's judgment also on Babylon and that kind of thing. The people that oppress Israel, God's going to judge them one day. And shouldn't take those things away. I told you this morning that that I'd read some letters about Santa Claus. You know, isn't it something? You know, they write letters, Santa Claus, would you please heal AIDS? Yeah. Santa Claus, my mom is out of work. I have no dad living at home. Could you make ends meet? You know, they write letters to Santa Claus as if he's God. He's a thief. He's stealing from God. I want to just read you this. This is from the Forbes magazine. And it is the December 24th issue of it. Although what's written here is from the December 15th, 1933 issue. So they're reprinting this from 1933. It says this. One thing 1933 has taught American finance, American industry, American business, is that they must have Santa Claus on their payroll. Only because some modicum of Santa Claus spirit had leavened American economic life did we avert social revolution during the critical days since 1929. Of course, 1929 was that Great Depression started, the crash and all that. Looking ahead, the future is destined to bring either Santa Claus or state socialism, mayhap dictatorship. What is the fundamental, the inmost meaning, motive, mainspring of all that is being essayed under the New Deal? That finance, industry, business, labor, mankind must realize that it is in very truth its brother's keeper and act in harmony with that principle. There must be more equitable division of the sum of the proceeds of human toil, human ingenuity, human achievement. Starvation and Santa Claus can't reside in any land where there is enough for every decent man, woman, and child. It will not suffice to have Santa Claus enthroned only in Washington. 1933, that was written. Can you imagine? Santa Claus. Wow. You know, hey, lots of years parents have given their children the hope, the dream, in a fictitious character, Santa Claus. And then, of course, they wonder why their children won't believe in God, whom they can't see either. Santa Claus steals faith from the heart of young people. That's what he steals, takes their faith from them. So I want to go on a Bible journey, and I told you this one's going to be quite the Bible journey, so here we go. I want you to see how he steals the glory from the Lord Jesus Christ. Start out with me in Deuteronomy chapter 6. Boy, all of you said, we skipped over Genesis, Leviticus, Numbers, praise the Lord. We don't have to go through those. All right, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6 through 9. Here's what we know. Scripture says, we should be familiar with this. It says this, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. And that's about God, but they do it about Santa Claus. They got books about Santa, they tell them about Santa's coming and all that stuff, and they decorate their house, the outside of their house, with Santa Claus and that kind of thing, amen? Now, we do it more for Jesus Christ, put stickers on our cars and that kind of thing, but for Santa Claus, they put him right out front, blow up balloons of him and all this stuff in the front yard. You know, they teach him. Doing the same kind of thing, not the way it ought to be, amen? And by the way, I just want you to know that Brother John Knox gave me the idea for this message, so I'll give him credit where credit is due, and so I'll give him that. All right, go with me, the book of Job. You say, oh wow, praise God, he jumped a big jump there. Book of Job, chapter 38, verse 4 through 7. Job, chapter 38. Verse 4 through 7. And we read this. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if thou hast understanding. Who hath laid the measures thereof, if thou knowest? Or who hath stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. And who was there? Who did all that? The Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He did all those things. He was there. And he's not bound by time.
That's
right. Did you ever stop and think about it? Santa Claus isn't bound by time. He has millions of homes to visit in one night. How can he do that? Physically impossible. He's got like 0.02.7 seconds to be in each home if he's going to visit all the homes. You know, and he's got to stop the sled, get off the sled, get the presents out, go down the chimney, put the presents under the tree, eat the milk and cookies, get back up the chimney, get back in the sled, and go all on off in 0.02.7 seconds. Not going to happen, I don't think. Amen. But he's a robber. He steals this idea of the timelessness of Jesus. Go with me to Psalm 48, verse 1 and 2, please. Psalm 48, verse 1 and 2. We have here, Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great King. Jesus is the joy of the whole earth, amen, except for this time of year. Then Satan's the joy. Now here's another thing. If you were to stop the normal person coming out of a church that's supposedly a Christian church, and ask them, when Jesus comes and takes us out, snatches us away, translates us in what they call the rapture, which way are we going to go? Most Christians would look at you and go, well, I don't know, up, right? Ask anybody, where does Santa Claus live? Every one of them will tell you, lives in the north, lives at the North Pole. Here he is here, on the sides of the north, the city of the great King. It's God's city is up north of here. Amen, folks? But Santa Claus says it's where he lives. Go with me to Isaiah chapter 50 and verse number 6. Isaiah chapter 50, verse number 6. Isaiah 50, verse 6 says this. I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. And of course, we know that's Jesus at his trial and then crucifixion. They plucked the beard right off from his face. Most of us don't realize this, but ever since World War II, the idea of men having facial hair is a no-no. Not a good thing anyway. I mean, it's coming back some, but still not the big popular thing. I mean, before World War II, a lot of men, you see, presidents of the United States had full beards and all that kind of thing. But World War II really put the stop to all that. Short hair, clean shaven face, that kind of thing. But not Santa Claus. Santa Claus always got to have whiskers. Got to have big beard, big bushy old beard, doesn't he? Stealing from the Lord Jesus Christ, the picture that we have here. Old Saint Nick's got to have that long hair and beard on him. He does that kind of thing. Here's the fifth one, if you're counting. Isaiah chapter 63 and verse number 2. Isaiah 63, verse number 2. We read this about Jesus. Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine fat? And we're reading about what Jesus is going to do when he comes back and he avenges Israel, and he's going to have the blood running as high as the bridle on a horse up and down that valley of Megiddo, that battle of Armageddon, and his garments are going to be stained with blood. You would not see Santa Claus come out to the mall in a chartreuse outfit. You'd never see him in pink, orange, blue. Got to be red. Always is red, has been red for years and years and years and years and years. Red's the symbol of the blood of the Lord Jesus, but Santa steals that from him in his garments here. Let me go on to Matthew chapter 26. Amen. Matthew chapter 26, verse 29. Matthew chapter 26 and verse 29. The Word of God tells us this. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And Jesus didn't have anything more to eat after that point, but there were times when he was back with his disciples that he did eat. Now give me something to eat, bring me this. And he ate the honeycomb. And then when they had the food by the shore, he had he was cooking the fish for them there and that kind of thing. Jesus can eat and he is going to eat. Isn't that true? Mm-hmm. Well, Santa Claus, you ever stop and think about it? Every one of those millions of homes that he stops at got milk and cookies. I mean, no wonder the guy's fat. Amen? I mean, no wonder. I mean, he just keeps eating and eating. He must have an incredible body. Did you ever stop and think about that? What an incredible body he must have. He must be immortal. He's ageless. Just like the Lord Jesus Christ. It's amazing, isn't it? Just amazing. Yeah. What he can do. Go with me, Mark chapter 9, Mark's Gospel chapter 9, and verse 36 and 37. Mark chapter 9, 36 and 37. I'm telling you, Satan is too, but Santa's a thief. Yeah, steals the glory. Mark chapter 9, 36 and 37, and he took a child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his arms, he said unto them, Whosoever shall receive one of such children in my name receiveth me. And whosoever shall receive me receiveth not me, but him that sent me. And here's a great picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. Suffer the little children to come unto me. Amen. No better picture. Jesus will receive children. Hey, look at Santa Claus. There he is in the mall. He's in the store. He's got the kids on his lap. What's he doing? Picking up those children, putting them on his lap, and receiving them that way, making them into his prophets, taking the place of Jesus Christ in their hearts. It's just incredible what he does. Would you go with me to Mark chapter 16 and verse number 15? Mark 16, verse 15. The end of the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Isn't that what he told us to do? That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to get out there and do that. Do you know of a place where Santa can't go? Do you know any place that stops or bars Santa Claus from coming in? I mean, Santa goes to the hospital, Santa goes to the nursing home, Santa goes to the, you know, to the malls and to the housing projects and all that kind of thing. He goes everywhere and makes disciples of himself, makes people believe in him. He certainly went big into Hollywood, and they've got all kinds of movies about him. It's just incredible, isn't it, how he goes. All right, let's move on to John's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 34. John's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 34. John 7, 34, Jesus says this, ye shall seek me and shall not find me. And where I am, thither ye cannot go, or cannot come. That's about Jesus Christ, and he's telling the men about that. Do you realize that Santa Claus lives at the North Pole? Do you know anyone who's ever visited him? Any of you? Ever been there? Know of anybody? Heard anybody write about being there? No. So he steals the glory from the Lord Jesus. You can't go there. You can't find him wherever he is. Let me move on here. In John's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 12 and 13. John chapter 12, verse 12 and 13. On the next day, much people that were come to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palms and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. Oh, wow, 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 what a great thing. Wednesday night, Lord willing, we'll come back to this passage. Lord willing, we'll see how that goes this Wednesday night. But wow, this is just incredible. Jesus Christ coming in, offering himself as the king, willing to set up the kingdom right then. Wow, just incredible, isn't it? Great thing, don't you think? You'd better not have a Christmas parade without Santa Claus. Amen? You better not do that. Don't you dare, Macy's, put up a Christmas parade, not have Santa Claus as the finale. And everybody's watching. Here come all those bands, marching bands with the girls with nothing on in front of them. And here comes all the men on the horses. And here comes all the bagpipes. And here comes all these things, you know, this float of Snoopy Dog and all these things going by. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And what's everybody waiting for? Santa Claus at the very end of that parade. They're lined up just like this, taking the glory from the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you think that they'd all be waiting for, here's the finale, the grand finale, and it's the manger scene coming down the street? No. They'd all turn and leave before it came down. There'd be a few of us Christians standing there saying, praise God, Jesus was born. But no, no, they'll all stand there shiver in the rain, in the wind, in the snow, waiting for Santa Claus to come at the very end of the parade. Go with me, if you would, please, here. John's Gospel, chapter 20, and verse 19. John's Gospel, chapter 20, verse 19. We read this, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. Here's our Savior. He's able to come in. What about old Santa Claus? You can lock your doors, shut every window in the place, but he can still get in. You know, he's got the same attribute that Jesus Christ has here. He can get through anywhere. And I've seen some chimneys that are pretty small. I don't know how that fat man gets it down there. I don't know what he weighs, 250, 300. He keeps getting bigger, you know. It's kind of interesting. Although, I don't know, maybe this year when he stops at the White House, Michelle Obama will talk to him about he's not a good role model for the kids, and maybe he'll trim down a little bit to about 220 or so. Who knows? But he's hard to be jolly if you're skinny. Amen? So, he comes right in. Isn't that incredible that we see that? He can get right in. Then take a look with me here at John 21, verse 25, the very last verse of John's Gospel. Look at this. It says this, "And there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written." Amen. About Jesus. I mean, you couldn't end the... I mean, I'd write a book about what he's done in my life. Amen. Every one of us could write a book about what he's done in our... Hey, isn't it amazing? They keep coming out with new stories about Santa Claus. Keep coming out with new songs about Santa Claus. It's just amazing. They just keep going with Santa Claus. New movies. We came in, when Jeannie and I came in, they had something on the television. There's Santa up there on there. I thought, isn't that something that we'd have that? All right, go with me, if you would, to Romans chapter 12 and verse number 2. You know this verse, Romans chapter 12, verse number 2. I hope you, by way of internet, are turning to all these passages. It's a big journey we're going on, but we're going to get there. Romans chapter 2, verse 2 says, "And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." That's a good challenge for us, something that we ought to do. Christians ought not to look like the world. Amen? Be not conformed to this world. Isn't that what it says? That's what it says. That's what the Word of God tells us that we're not to do. And, hey, how about old Santa Claus? You ever see Santa Claus with a beer in his hand? You ever see Santa Claus smoking a cigarette? Maybe, yeah. Now, the other day, Jeannie and I saw Santa Claus. He was eating his lunch and texting on his phone. I thought, oh, isn't that funny? Doesn't that work out for the message? You ever see a Santa Claus carrying a Playboy magazine while he's sitting there reading a magazine on the thing? You know? Santa Claus got to be an upright role model for all those kids, doesn't he? Stealing this verse right here. He's not conformed to the world. He's doing what we ought to be doing. Amen? And that kind of thing. Go with me, if you would, to Philippians chapter 4 and verse number 6. Philippians chapter 4, verse number 6. Philippians 4, 6 says, "Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God." I think you know where I'm going with this one. Most people ask Santa Claus for things way before they'll ask God for anything. They'll ask him for all kinds of things. It's just amazing. They make their request made known unto Santa Claus and not unto God. Just incredible, don't you think? I think it's incredible myself. Go with me now to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse number 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 2. God's word says this, "For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night." That's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. When he comes back, we're not going to know. We won't be able to understand it. A thief in the night. Hey, Santa Claus comes as a thief. You never see him. You don't see him come. He doesn't ring the doorbell. You know? He's like, we have a UPS guy that does this to us. You know? all of a sudden, here's a package, and you had no idea that he was there. You know, he must be related to Santa Claus. Santa Claus, what's that?
I said you could ask him.
Yeah, I could. I should ask him, yeah. If I could ever see him, you know. I never know which door he's going to leave it at, you know, and I never hear him pulling away on Don or on Blitzen and all those kinds of things. I never hear that, huh? Comes as a thief. You don't even know he's been there. Wow. Just incredible kinds of things here. All right, go with me if you would. The book of Hebrews, chapter 4, and verse 13. We're making progress, folks. Hang in there with me. You know, I won't be pulling anything out of the concordance. So, you know, when I get to Revelation, we'll be done. All right, Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 13. Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 13, it says this, "Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do." And, of course, this is talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. He can see everything about us. Doesn't matter if it's dark. Doesn't matter where we are. We can go into some cave. You know, he sees us no matter what. What is the whole mystique about Santa Claus? Is that he sees every one of us, knows whether we're naughty or nice. Yeah. And you know, he's robbing from God. Santa Claus sees everyone. All right, let me go on now. Book of Revelation, chapter number 1, verse 8. Book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse number 8. We read this, "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty." He's the beginning and the ending. Anyone know when Santa Claus was born? You ever hear Santa Claus's birth date? Anybody? It's got no beginning. Does he have an ending? I mean, he's never died, even though there's a movie out where, you know, he dies and the guy who killed him now becomes Santa Claus. Yeah. No beginning, no ending, you know. Lives forever. Isn't that kind of an incredible thing? Jesus is the eternal God, and so is Santa Claus. He, you know, I'm amazed. I mean, as overweight as he is, you'd think he'd have diabetes, you know, or he'd have heart problems, you know, or maybe he'd get cancer, you know, or food poisoning. I mean, somebody left the milk out too long, you know, by the time he got there, it was spoiled, you know. No, none of those kinds of things. Not Santa Claus. Eternal. Go with me to chapter 1, verse 14. Chapter 1, verse 14, the description of Jesus Christ. But here, verse 14 says, "His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire." Jesus Christ. Did you ever see a dark-haired Santa Claus? You know, brown-haired, black-haired. How about a red-headed Santa Claus? You ever see a redhead? Santa only comes with white hair, stealing the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. His head and his hairs were white like wool. Yeah, that's how Santa Claus is. And he steals that glory from him. All right, go with me if you would. Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created." Now, it's true. We don't see people going around bowing down to Santa Claus or his statue or anything like that. We don't see that. But you notice it talks here about all things were created for thy pleasure and that kind of thing. You know, God uses animals. Remember? Balaam's donkey talked to Balaam. God used a donkey. Isn't it amazing? Santa Claus has made reindeer fly. Now, I've seen studies of reindeer from all over the Northland, and not one of the species can fly. There's not a one. And of all of them, there's not a one that has a red nose that lights up at night. But Santa Claus created one that did. He's got one. It's just amazing, isn't it? What Santa can do. He can make them fly, and he talks to them and all that kind of thing. And in the cartoons, the animals will even talk to Santa Claus. Just amazing to me, don't you think? Maybe you don't think so, but I think it's amazing. Amen? What Santa can do, the things that only God can do. Would you go with me to Revelation chapter 20 and verse number 12? Revelation chapter 20, verse number 12. Here's what we see. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Lord Jesus Christ has given all judgment. He's going to be there, and those books are going to be open. The book of life, the Bible, the book of remembrance, the book of records, they're all going to be opened, showing those people that they're worthy of hell. The lake of fire forever and ever and ever. Hey, Santa Claus has his books too. Got his naughty and his nice book. Isn't that amazing? Got his book. Naughty and nice list. You know what's funny, though? Even the naughty get things. Isn't it amazing? By the way, I saw that President Obama took over the naughty and nice list. Over top of the naughty side, he put down everyone rich. Over on the nice side, he put down all taxes. Yeah, the naughty and nice list for Mr. Obama. Oh, me, Revelation chapter 20 and verse 15. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. When Jesus Christ cast them into the lake of fire, they're not going to argue with Jesus. They aren't. Did you ever notice? You can't argue with something Santa Claus has given to you. Mom or dad gave it to you, or brother or sister gave it to you. You can say, oh, I don't want this, and got to give it back. But if it's got Santa's name on there, there's no more argument. It's a done deal, unless it doesn't fit. And mom says something like, well, we'll see if the store will take it back. We'll see if what Santa gave you can be returned. Final authority of Santa Claus. He gave it to you. That's what you're getting. Here we go. You ready? Revelation chapter 21, verse 18 and 19. Revelation 21, 18 and 19. And the building of the wall of it was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third a chalcedony, the fourth an emerald, and it goes on there. Speaking about God's magnificence, what things he's going to do, the wealth and riches of God. Have you ever thought that anyone would say, well, I'm going to ask Santa Claus for this, but he might not be able to do it. He might not have enough money to buy it. He might not have enough resources to make it in his little shop. He might not have enough little elves to put it together for me. Did you ever hear anybody doubt whether Santa Claus has the power and wealth to do all those presents for all those kids? Have you ever seen an editorial in a paper anywhere where somebody wrote and said, you know, it's hard economic times, maybe Santa Claus can't give you everything you want this year? You never see it. See, he's a thief. He robs from God all the riches that God has. He's got them and more. Amen. He's got them and more. Here's the last one, Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 12. Revelation chapter 22, verse number 12 says this, "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be." That's what the Lord Jesus Christ says. He's coming quickly. He's going to bring his rewards with him. That's Jesus. But let me ask you this. When do kids get their presents? It's not until Santa Claus comes. Isn't that right? Can't have your presents. I can remember as a child growing up in a household where we were taught all about Santa Claus and that kind of thing. We had in our house a staircase that came down, and the railing part of the staircase, there was a wall, railing part looked at the living room. Being the Catholic family that we were, we had to go to Mass first, and we had to have communion, and back in those days, in order to have communion, you couldn't eat. So we'd get up, get dressed for church, and then have to go down those stairs, and we couldn't look at the tree. We had to go out the back door of the house, even though the car was parked at the front of the house, go all the way around. We lived in a housing project, so we had to go all the way around the projects, you know, to get to the front of the house to where the car was. And then when we came home, Devin, we had to go back all the way around, come in the back door, and eat breakfast before we could go and see what was under the tree. But it had to be after Santa Claus came. So he steals that glory from the Lord Jesus Christ. It's just amazing to me. You know, stop and think about this. A man works hard for his money, saves some, puts it aside. Maybe he's got one of them Christmas club things or something, but he gets the money and finally he gets some gifts for his kids. Then puts Santa Claus' name on there so that the kids will give their heart to Santa rather than to him. Don't understand that kind of thing. I really, really, really don't. I got a couple other things here that I'd like to just share with you. I'm not going to have you turn to a verse for it. I think you could look them up on your own. But do you realize that Jesus is a righteous judge? You know, he is a righteous judge. He'll reward good and he'll punish evil. But Santa Claus, even though he's got a naughty and nice list, trying to help the kids to be nice all year round, he'll give presents to all the naughty ones too. It's just amazing. Jesus is not that way. Here's another thing about Jesus. Jesus is true to his bride. You know, we're his bride. He's true to us. But did you ever stop and think about it? Mrs. Claus stays back at the North Pole. And while Santa Claus is here, we make up a song, "I Saw Mommy Kissing Santa Claus Under the Mistletoe Last Night." He's an adulterer. Did you think about that? Another thing about Jesus, the third thing is that Jesus is a perfect gentleman. Scripture shows us that he's waiting outside the door. He's knocking, but he won't come in unless he's invited. But Santa Claus barge right in every single year into those homes. He comes in anyway. Another thing about Jesus, a fourth thing about him, Jesus was a man's man. Do you really think those fishermen would have followed him if he was effeminate? I don't think so. I mean, he was a carpenter, hauled the lumber around, sawed, nailed, did all those things that he had to do, worked the planes and fit it all together. I mean, he had rough hands. He could walk through the mountainside with the rest of them. You know, they didn't carry him on something. He was a man's man. Now, think about this with me a little bit. If you know anything about any of the Romance languages, you know, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, French, Romanian, those are the Romance languages. They have saints, and they call them like San Juan, Saint John. Amen? You know, they got San Francisco, Saint Francis. That's Spanish. Latin, Italian, Roman languages, French, okay? But then they have Santa Barbara, Saint Barbara, you know? How come it's Santa Claus? Maybe the kissing mommy under the mistletoe is just to hide the fact that he's really homosexual. He goes by Santa Claus, that's feminine. He's got a feminine name? Maybe we shouldn't say he's a jolly old soul, we should call him a gay old fella. I don't know. And then here's a fifth thing, I just throw this out there for you. I think you'll find it kind of amusing. Somebody with too much time on their hands started calculating how it would be possible, even if you give Santa Claus 36 hours, you know, because of the way the time is all around the planet, you know, so for him to get, you know, when it starts to be nighttime, the first, Christmas Eve, the first time night comes, and you start going all the way around the planet, you know, and give him all those hours. It works out to about 36 hours to visit all those millions and millions and millions of homes around the world so he can bring presents to all those little boys and girls, right? They said some things, they calculated all these things out, that for him to go, I told you he'd only have to have, he could only have 0.02.7 seconds in each home. But then to get from home to home, now, you know, inner city, they're right next door to each other, you know, like in Baltimore, they got those row houses, you know, okay. But then you go to someplace like Wyoming, Montana, Siberia, help me out here. You know, you're not going to get from this one to that one. The speed that his sleigh would have to go, that those reindeer would have to go, would be so incredibly fast, sonic booms would be breaking windows everywhere. And not only that, the speed of all that would be so much that the reindeer would burn up in a flame, and so would the sleigh and Santa and all those presents. And to think about moving that much weight that quickly. You know, inertia is that idea that things at rest want to stay at rest, things in motion want to keep in motion, and to get them to change takes a lot of energy. And the weight of the reindeer, the sleigh, Santa, give him 250, all those presents. That's a lot of weight to get moving. Ask somebody who operates a train. That's a lot of weight to get moving and to get it up to that speed that quick. Santa's a liar and Santa's a thief. He's taken the glory from the Lord Jesus Christ. He's stolen the faith of boys and girls for years and years around the world and put it to himself. And he can't come through. The real things that really are important he cannot give. The gift of eternal life is the most important gift, and he can't give it. He can't give it. I'll just close. A man was pretending to be one of the Santa Clauses at a mall, and he said this: every time a child would ask for a train, he'd ask the child, "Now, if I get you that train, are you sure you're going to let Daddy play with you and that train?" Well, he asked this one little boy, and the boy hesitated for a little while. And so Santa, fake Santa, thought, and little boy's a little shy, maybe I'll help him along with the conversation, that kind of thing. And so he said to the little boy, "Well, then, what else can I get you for Christmas?" And the little boy said, "Another train." In other words, give me two of them, because if Daddy play with the one, I'll play with the other. Oh, me, folks, what a society we live in, huh? So willing and open to have Santa Claus. And I told you this a long time ago, I've said it several times, when I worked at the cell phone place, the Jewish young fella and I were told to put up the Christmas tree. So we put up the Christmas tree. We put at the top, because that's all we could find, we put Santa Claus up at the top, the Christmas tree. Well, the district manager came in, and she saw that Santa Claus up there, and this is honestly what she said. You can't have a religious symbol on the tree. Gotta have that thing off. Took it off, went out and bought a star that lit up to put on the tree. Can't have a religious symbol. Santa Claus, a religious symbol. Times are upside down. What's right is wrong, what's wrong is right. And Santa Claus is a thief. Don't believe in him. Let's bow together. John, pray that God bless, if you would, please.
Lord Jesus, we thank you that you're much more than Santa Claus, and that you're, in fact, diametrically opposed to him, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that you're true, that if we share about you with others, that it's the truth, it's not a lie. And Lord, it hurts our hearts that young children are lied to this time of year, and that the true reason for this time of year is to celebrate the birth of the Messiah, that you're came to take our sin upon you, Lord, and to save all mankind. And it just hurts, Lord, that it's so covered up today. And we ask, Lord, that you come and set things right. It's the only way things are going to be truly right is for you to return and to set up your kingdom on earth, Lord, and to reign from Jerusalem on thy throne. And we look forward to that day, Lord. We ask you to come and not tarry. But until that time, Lord, may you fill us with thy Holy Spirit, that we may speak the truth in this dark world and share you with others. And may hearts be pricked through thy Holy Spirit. And may revival start, Lord, as soon as possible in this town, in this county, in this state, and across this nation, Lord. May thy Holy Spirit move upon the souls of men, and may they be convicted of their sin and believe on Jesus Christ before it's too late, Lord. And may there be much rejoicing in heaven over souls saved today and in the days to come. And may we play a part in it, Lord, and share with you in that joy. And may Jesus get all the glory and honor in it all. In thy holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Lord bless you, folks. I hope I didn't just ruin your Christmas.